Praise God. Praise God. Let the people of God say amen. Amen. I welcome you to the Bread Broadcast, the Bible teaching program where we edify, we exalt, and challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here, we also call sinners to salvation through the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us. Today, we are going to be talking about one more enemy, okay? And his name is Heman. Defeating Heman, your generational enemy. And our case study is a wonderful lady, and her name is Queen Esther. Queen Esther. Esther means star, you see. And the short reading is Esther, the book of Esther in the Old Testament, chapter 4. We will start from verse 1, we start at 17. I've read it, you ought to too. Esther, chapter 4, verse 1, we start at 17. Let us pray. Father, thank you. Dear Lord Jesus, we honor you. Hallowed be your holy name. Sweet, blessed Holy Spirit, be thou glorified. Father, through our Lord Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit, we ask that your word will come to our hearts. And Father, you will use your word to open our ears and open our eyes to teach us strategies to overcome generational enemy. And let Jesus alone be glorified, Holy Spirit, and to the glory of God the Father. In Jesus' name. Amen. Now, amen. Our foundation text is the epistle of Apostle Paul to the church at Ephesus, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. If you're a Bible student, you are already saying what I'm about to read. You see, it's good to be a Bible student, right? For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities. Listen up, please. Against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age. Against spiritual hosts of wickedness. These are horrible beings we are talking about in the heavenly places. They are not nice. These are demon spirits. They are horrible. So the Bible says we are not fighting against humans, but against these principalities, powers, rulers of the darkness of this age. They are in heavenly places, in the second heaven. So what is a generational enemy? What is Heman, or who is Heman? A generational enemy is anything, please listen up, that has successfully detoured, detained, or destroyed the vision or the destinies of previous generations and still continues to work against the current generation. You see, if you look down, I was talking to somebody a couple of years or more ago, and I was talking about generational curse, and at first she didn't quite get it. And I began to expand on that by the Spirit of God. And it clicked, you see. In some families, their problem is divorce. Great-grandpa divorced, grandpa divorced, pa divorced, and now he or she is on that path too. That's a generational curse, a generational error. In some families, it's untimely death. In some families, it's alcoholism. It's all kinds of stuff that this evil spirit, they attack people with. But we are going to talk about it tonight or today, depending on where you are on the globe. And we will see how God gives his children the victory. Can a generational enemy be defeated? The answer is a resounding yes. In the name of Jesus, in the power of the Holy Spirit, generational enemies can be destroyed. Yes, they can be defeated. How can we, like Esther, overcome a generational enemy like Haman? Number one, stand strong. You stand strong when you prepare yourself mentally. Acquaint yourself with what your family history says. A lot of people, they are just bumbling all over the place. They are too busy and running around and they are going nowhere. Sit down a little bit. The problem you are facing in your life, trace it back. Can you see a pattern in the family? From both sides of the families, is there a pattern? Stop bumbling around. We need to acquaint ourselves with what our family history says. Know what the Lord has promised through his word. Now I'm talking to believers. And see what God is calling you to do in this situation. As a child of God, you have been put in that family to rewrite history. So if the problem in maybe one or both sides of the family is getting married to the wrong person, and now that is staring you in the face too, then ask God, Lord, how do I rewrite the history? How do you want to use me like Esther in this case? You see, acting on the spiritual truth that God will never allow his integrity to be impeached, we form the foundation of our mental strength to face whatever we have to face in the race set before us. Esther began winning a battle by first mentally preparing herself that this job has to be done, regardless of the consequences, you see. When you come to a point to say, listen, Grandpa could have been an alcoholic, great-grandpa, my dad, and uncles, aunties, and everybody, I refuse to go that path. When you get to that level, then you are talking business, you see. And God does business with people who are serious with the business of the kingdom, you see. When you take things seriously, then God says, okay, I have a candidate that I can use, you see. The Lord Jesus said, which one of you plans to build a tower and will not first count the cost? In the book of Luke, 14:28. So we must be ready to give the fight whatever it takes to overcome in Jesus' name. It's not something that we can do on impulse. No. Let's go to Colossians chapter 3, verse 10. Colossians 3:10. And I put on the new man. Who is the new man? The new man is the new nature that we received when we became saved. That is the new man. 1 Corinthians 5:17 says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. You see, that is the new man. The new nature that we receive and is renewed in knowledge, you see. I always tell people, Christians, we are intelligent people because it takes intelligence to receive, to say you are spiritually bankrupt and you need Jesus. It takes intelligence to do that, you see. So our mind is being renewed in knowledge according to the image of him, Christ, who created him, that is a new nature, you see. So we don't do things haphazardly or impulsively. No, we think things through. That is standing strong. And I took my time on that. To stand on God's word is to plan from God's rock, because that is the foundation of our fight. If we are going to fight and win, is standing strong mentally in the power of the word of God. To stand on God's word is to plan from God's work. Moving on. Suit up. So Esther did not only stand strong. Now we are talking suit up. This is to immerse ourselves in the word of God. We need to know what biblical principles are. We sure do. Christians, they say, oh, I've been praying to God, I've been praying to God. We are quick to pray, but we are not ready or willing to go through the pages of the Bible to look for spiritual principles that speaks to our situation. We need to know these biblical principles and how to avoid breaking those principles, and what are the consequences of keeping or breaking spiritual principles. God is a God of principles. We need to know if your family generational curse or enemy is, for example, people not breaking out to be who God has called them to be, you want to see what happened. And you want to go into the Word of God to know the kind of prayers you are going to be praying from the Word of God, to know what you are supposed to guard against in your life. So you don't go the same way that the generations before you have gone, you see. This will help us to wage war with wisdom. Esther knew the rules of the kingdom, that a queen must not come uninvited, you see. Esther knew that the time was running out for the Jews, so she knew the principles from both sides. Nevertheless, she also knew about the rule of the God of heaven, who can overrule the kings of the earth. You see, Esther knew the kingdom's rule, in the Babylonian kingdom's rules. She knew that. She knew the rule that had gone out against the Jews, and she also knew about the rule of the God of heaven. You see, we need to know these things. We just don't come and say, using prayer like sorcery, like my senior pastor would say. A lot of Christians, they use prayers like to conjure miracles, to conjure magic. God doesn't work like that. No, he works by his principles, you see. So therefore, Esther called for 3 days fasting. This was dressing up herself spiritually. Now, for some of you, for example, if you are in a family that they are pagans, they are all pagans, you are the only Christian there. I will give you that example. The spiritual principle that is guiding you, if you are in that situation, is to separate yourself. The book of Jeremiah says, come out of her, you see. I know you love them, they're your biological families and all that, but you've got to separate yourself from that spiritual madness. If you want your life to be different, that doesn't mean you're not going to be talking to your families. No. That doesn't mean if they call you, you're not going to be talking to them. No. But if they have all these family traditions that they do, you don't show up. No. Because it's the same tradition that they have been keeping, that is making all of them to be collective captives to that demonic madness that is going on. So you have to separate yourself, you see. That's just an example. So it's different for different situations. So you look through the Bible for the spiritual principle that talks to your own family situation. So Esther called for 3 days fasting. That is Esther suiting herself up spiritually. To face a physical fight, that has its root in the spiritual. We have to suit up. Every war has its strategies. A believer's war strategies are contained in the Bible. Pastor Chastani will say 18 inches. I don't know. I don't know if his Bible is or mine. But you say everything is contained in between 18 inches from the beginning to the end, you see. Failure to be intimate with the Word of God is to fail to know the secret of the enemy and how to defeat the enemy. David rejected Saul's armor because he could not fight in them. So it is with everyone who is fighting the battle of life with the sermon they heard from a pastor or other sources. Listen, I thank God for this ministry where I work, and I thank God for this program because the Holy Spirit has called me to do this. And the Holy Spirit tells me what to preach every week. But you cannot rely on what you hear from this program to fight your battle. No, I am just an appetizer, you see, pointing you to the Bible. You need to get into the Word of God to find the Word of God that He has for you, for your situation. Because what you get, what God gives you from here, nobody can take it away from you, you see. So if you rely on your pastor's preachings or Josephine Zion's Bible teachings, thinking that's what you're going to use to fight your battle, it's like fighting using another person's armor. You need to get your own word. It's like fighting with another man's Bible gears. It will yield little or no results. So you need to get your own weapon from the Word of God. Let's go to Proverbs chapter 8, verse 10. We stop at 11. Proverbs 8, 10 to 11. Receive my instruction and not silver, and knowledge rather than choice gold. For wisdom is better than rubies, and all the things one may desire cannot be compared with her. That is wisdom. The Bible says Christ is the wisdom and power and the power of God. You see, when you get into the Word of God, it's the book of wisdom. And the Lord will give you wisdom, instruction, knowledge on how to fight your battle. To fight with the right tools is to strike with the right tools. Listen, there's nothing as, frustrating as working with a dull tool when you are trying to cut something and the tool is dull, it's not sharp. That is very frustrating. The same if you are relying on second-hand sermon to fight your battle. No, you have to get it yourself from the Word of God. To fight with the right tools is to strike with the right tools. Moving on. So Esther was standing strong. Then we talked about suit up. Now we are talking stand firm. This is a make or break moment when we hit a bump in the road and we are faced with challenges in the fight. God told the children of Israel to take over the land of Canaan. But guess what? They were engaged in fight after fight, fighting all kinds of people. 66 wars they fought before the final thing. That God is calling you to break a generational curse or defeat a generational enemy doesn't mean it's going to be easy or through. No. The enemy does not give up a territory easily. No. The enemy will fight back. But since God is the one calling you to do this, it doesn't matter the challenge, you hold on. Okay, so a time is coming in the journey that you will need to stand firm, because you will hit a challenge in the middle of the fight. Our decision to retreat or advance will decide the outcome. Esther came to such a point when, after she had fasted, she dressed up to appear before the king uninvited. You can imagine Esther's mindset at that point. She knows the rule. You don't appear before the king if you have not been called. She dressed up anyway, and she showed up. You see, the king could have said, take her head off. At that point, it's a make or break point. At this point, we can only rely on the unfailing mercy and promises of God. This is where we act out our faith indeed. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego boasted to Nebuchadnezzar that the God they serve would deliver them. However, they quickly added that even if he would not deliver them, they would still not worship King Nebuchadnezzar's idol. If we are to move beyond the fear barrier, listen up real close. Our faith needs to have "even if he would not" clause in it. For you to move beyond that fear barrier, you need to get to a point that, you know what, it doesn't matter whether God saved me or not, but since he's the one that said, do this, I don't care, I'm on it. When we get to that level, then we are ready, okay? Like the three Hebrew men, Esther said, if I die, I die, you see. This kind of mindset will help us to stand by our resolve, regardless of what the consequences our faith fight may bring. For example, God told Abraham to leave his hometown and go to a place he will show him. Abraham did not know where he was going, but he left anyway. He left to be separated from the curses of idol worship, of Mesopotamia, to become a blessing. You want to tell me there was not a time that Abraham felt like, am I crazy? God told me to leave my country to a place he would show me. I don't even know the place. But you know what? He packed up. He's like, I don't know where I'm going. I'll see where this goes, but it doesn't matter. I'm going anyway. We have to get to that level. Jeremiah 29:11 is a popular Bible verse. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. You see, this is where our faith comes in. If God has called you to do something, don't worry about the consequences. Because God, who has called you to do it, he has a good plan, a good thought towards you. God will not call you to something that will destroy you. Oh no. Mm-mm-mm. It may be tough and rough, but God will never call his children to something that will destroy them if we follow in obedience. To set your gaze on the Lord is to set your faith to be strong. Let's say that again. It's so beautiful. To set your gaze on the Lord is to set your faith to be strong. Moving on. Stay down. I love this. When the king asked Esther to state a petition, Esther exposed Haman without any reservations. Listen, she was not merciful to Haman. She exposed him thoroughly. She exposed Haman's motive, which was a generational hatred for the Jews. and that his flight was not because of his concern for the king's honor. She exposed Haman's method of evil operation, which was to exterminate all the Jews. Victory cannot be achieved over Haman until our obedience is complete. I wish I had the time, but I'm already out of time. The disobedience of Esau led to the eventual birth of Amalek. God told the children of Israel not to marry their idol worshippers, the Canaanites. Abram sent Eliezer, his servant, to another place to go get a wife for Isaac. He said, make sure you don't marry, you don't hook my son Isaac up to any of the Canaanite women, because God has said don't. Okay? Isaac gave birth, was the father of Jacob and Esau. And Jacob traveled back to Syria to go marry there. Of course, it's because it caused some trouble. But Esau married a Canaanite woman. He ended up marrying three of them. And his firstborn, Eliphaz, gave birth to Amalek. Can you see? The problem began with Esau. And it was Amalek that later became a nation. Guess what? About 2,000 years after, one of the children of Amalek, the progenies, Haman, was the one that was now looking for a way to destroy the Jews. You see how it came down from generation to generation, you see. And the disobedience of King Saul made way for the eventual rise of the modern enemy of the Jews at the time, called Haman. God told King Saul to go and exterminate the Amalekites. He did not kill all of them, you see. Out of that came Haman. So every generational curse always starts with disobedience. When man or woman declares their independence of God, then there's trouble. So if you want to defeat the generational curse or the generational enemy of your family, your obedience has to be complete, because what started it was disobedience. Let's go to Job chapter 14, verse 14b. Job 14, 14b. All the days of my hard service, I will wait till my change comes. We have to hang in there until the obedience is complete and the change comes. Stand still on your end until you see the end. Stand still on your end until you see the end. So what have we done so far? How can we overcome a generational enemy like Haman? Stand strong. This is to establish mental preparation for the fight through the word of God. Suit up. This is to examine, to understand the biblical strategies that guide us to victory. Stand firm. This is to encourage ourselves when engaging the enemy becomes challenging. Steer down. This is to exterminate the enemy through complete obedience to God. As believers, our fight is not against flesh and blood. Oh no. Every family problem is just a symptom of a fight that has its roots in the spirit realm. Our Lord Jesus said, apart from me, you can do nothing. The battles of life can only be fought and won by dwelling in Christ through complete obedience. Holy living through total obedience to the word of God is the major destroyer of generational enemies. Now, if you are an unbeliever, you are in a battle. Oh yeah. The problem is You are not just aware that you are fired. Oh yeah, your life is in danger and you don't even know. The calamities from such a living varies and can be sudden. But if you acknowledge your spiritual bankruptcy and you confess your need of a savior, you look at your life, you can see your life needs a change. And only Jesus can help you. The Lord Jesus will save you if you ask him. And your story will change. It doesn't mean you won't have battles to fight in life. That's not what I'm saying. No. But it means you won't fight alone. And you won't fight to lose. No. Now, if you are ready to change to the winning side, which is the Lord Jesus' side, a link is coming up. Click on that link and we will meet you there on what to do. Let us pray. Father, thank you. Help us, Holy Spirit, to be obedient Christians. That's what we are asking. The grace to have total obedience to the word of God. Lord, release it unto us. And for those people going to want to know Jesus Christ, Father, I pray for them. Give them understanding to know the contract they are about to sign with you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. I will see you next week, only if Jesus has not split the sky open.